Hello, everybody. Oops, that's the wrong slide deck. So I'll get started in talking about responsible tech. Tech is not neutral. But there's a whole lot of disagreement on what tech actually, whether it's good or bad. Those who live, you know, in Silicon Valley, many of you here probably think that tech is a strong force for good. Thank you. But I love this quote. I think that technologies are morally neutral until we apply them. It's only when we use them for good or evil that they become good or evil. And I think this is important to remember because it is how we use technology, how we think about technology, that matters. And what I want to talk to you about a little bit is becoming a tech pragmatist. This is based on survey results with many different business leaders, as well as people whose job is to think about responsible technology. But let's start with why now. First, we suffer consistently from unintended consequences. There's another great quote that basically we as technologists are lousy at predicting the consequences of the tech that we build. Now, no one else is any good either, but we are lousy. We are so focused as problem solvers on how what we are building is going to address a particular need that it's very difficult for us to see outside that. And unfortunately, as a population, we suffer inconsistently. Very often, those who have the least ability to respond are the ones that have the most negative unintended consequences. And so this is something that we want to think about. But why are we talking about this now? First, the increased complexity in our system and the increased interconnectedness between everything makes the consequences even more difficult to predict. You've got first-order consequences and second-order consequences and third-order consequences, and everything's so connected and it just explodes. And the footprint and the impact on our lives is vastly different. If Amazon gives me a bad recommendation based on a purchase I've made, nothing bad happens in my life. If a doctor gets a bad suggestion from an AI and recommends either a drug or a treatment for me that's wrong, well, that has much more severe consequences. We are now talking about applying technology in areas that impact our livelihoods, sometimes our lives. These systems are being used in the criminal justice system in the United States. One study showed that the systems used are just as accurate as paying somebody $10 on the street to decide whether or not somebody should get parole or not. Not a very stunning record. So how do we fix it? We've been talking a lot at ThoughtWorks about responsible tech. And we partnered with MIT Technology Review to survey many different business leaders about how they were applying this, what the problems were, what they were hoping to get out of it. And this is the definition that we use. This is two slides with lots of words. Responsible tech is the active consideration of values, unintended consequences, and the negative impact of technology. Responsible tech includes a wide variety of voices in adoption and deployment and seeks to manage and mitigate potential risk and harm to all communities affected by the technology. Now, unfortunately, they left off in this survey the part of the definition I like the best. Let's not forget that there are also positive opportunities. Not all unintended consequences are bad. It might be that in looking at these unintended consequences, you find a new market. You find a new target You find something that your product can do that you didn't think it could do that expands your market. So let's not get too hung up on all the negative consequences, because there can be positive unintended consequences as well. So one of the questions we ask is, what is the value to your business of thinking about responsible tech? Unfortunately, a lot of people started with compliance. Well, somebody's telling me I have to worry about this, so I'm going to worry about it. But there's also protection from brand harm, because when some of these things go wrong, that can have a negative impact on your organizational brand. Enhancement of the brand on the other side. So this is not just protecting from harm, but actually improving your brand as a result of this commitment. This is also important for employer brand, and particularly with the Gen Z. Many in this hiring cohort, they really care what their employer stands for. And they will leave an organization if they don't believe that they're acting responsibly and ethically. They want to be bought into the purpose. And we know, given how hard it is to attract and retain good talent, any edge you can get. So even though they start with compliance, organizations are recognizing that there is value to the business to be able to have a position on ethical tech. And this increased market opportunity. They believe that they will have a better message in the market and have a greater market opportunity if they think about ethical tech. And increased investor interest. ESG funds, ESG as a whole is getting much more attention. And being able to say you have a program that addresses this question of what is going on with my tech, who is being hurt, who is being helped, that goes a long way in the ESG space. So what are the kinds of things organizations are doing? They're coming up with guidelines and methodologies. I dealt with one bank in Australia, and they were trying to put together effectively a manifesto on what they would and wouldn't do with their clients' data. Interestingly, the woman who was leading this effort figured it would take about 3 months. When I talked to her, they were already 6 months into it, and they thought they might be done in another 3 months. These things are hard to do because you have to grapple with questions like, do I want to maximize profit or do I want to be fair? And you can't always get both. And those are difficult organizational questions. Data protection and privacy activities. So all of those notices and all of those structures that have been put in place. Compliance comes into this again, obviously, with things like the GDPR. But you want to invest in transparency. An important part of this is helping people understand the why of the decisions that you've made. How did you get to a place? And it takes investment. It's so much easier to just ignore this. It takes time, but you have to invest in this transparency to get those values that we just articulated. Audit and eliminate algorithmic bias. We talk a lot about algorithmic bias, but there are ways of uncovering it, and then there are organizations, independent organizations, just like you've got auditors that are going to audit your financial statements. There are organizations that will come in and audit your algorithm for bias. And so you can at least first understand, I didn't think my algorithm was biased, but then eliminate that bias. That might be through synthetic data, all kinds of other approaches, but there are ways of doing it. Obviously, sustainability, minimize your environmental impact, and diversify the workforce, because the more different perspectives you have looking at a problem, the more likely you're going to see that problem. And accessibility and inclusive design. More and more, this is actually becoming an imperative. We're getting back to compliance again. If your product is not accessible, you've automatically eliminated part of your target market. And what are the ways that this could go wrong internally? What are the barriers to adoption of ethical tech? Lack of senior management support and awareness. Of course, anything that takes more time, anything that's going to need to be invested in, you have to have senior management buy-in. And that's seen as a challenge by these business leaders. And of course, overall, there's organizational resistance to change. People do not like to change. They are afraid of it, and they are comfortable doing the way they things the way they've always done, and there's resistance. Competing priorities. This might slow things down. This might change your product some to address this. Do you have the investment to be able to do that? And then a lack of digital literacy. Fortunately, this problem is getting better, but it's amazing how many people will still say, oh, this can't be biased. It's an algorithm. Well, a person wrote the algorithm, and a system trained the model. Just because it's an algorithm does not mean it's unbiased. So I want to go back to this quote. Technology is morally neutral until we apply it. And what we as technologists need to start doing is thinking about not just the way we expect people to apply it, because it's going to solve the problem that we see, but what other ways could it be applied, and what might those consequences be, positive or negative? And this was one of my favorite comments from the report. We can make our technology more responsible if we believe we can and we insist that we do. We are developing tools to do things like audit for bias. Explainable AI allows us to see what is the decision-making basis. We can solve this problem. Even though we're lousy at it, we have more techniques available that will allow us to start to solve this problem. We can make our technology more responsible if we believe we can and we insist that we do. Thank you.